That's not what this program's about. As was indicated, the intelligence community is doing is looking at phone numbers and durations of calls. They are not looking at people's names, and they're not looking at content. But by sifting through this so-called metadata, they may identify potential leads with respect to folks who might engage in terrorism. If these folks, if the intelligence community then actually wants to listen to a phone call, they've got to go back to a federal judge. Now, with respect to the internet and emails, this does not apply to U.S. citizens, and it does not apply to people living in the United States. This program, by the way, is fully overseen not just by Congress, but by the FISA. You can't have 100% security and also then have 100% privacy and zero inconvenience. We're going to have to make some choices.
Tim, I'm going to start right off the bat with you. What is the dark web?
So the dark web is a collection of websites that are set up so that it's impossible to tell, not impossible, but very difficult to tell who runs them, where they're located, and that uses an anonymity technology called Tor that bounces traffic from server to server in a way that's encrypted so that it's very difficult to tell either who's doing the browsing or the core network, the core concept of bouncing traffic from server to server and having encryption so that each server only knows the server on either side but not the entire chain, that has proven very difficult for anybody, including the NSA, to crack.
A little graphic up here. The user's internet traffic is essentially routed through a series of random servers before reaching the final website that they're trying to visit, and each step has a layer of encryption which masks the user's identity. Kim, is this the only way through Tor that you can access the so-called sort of darker side of the web?
This is the limit that you could access. This name, the dark web, is a little funny to me.
Okay.
Because, well, we all know that these services exist, and as Tim pointed out, you know, the Tor network is used for a lot of legitimate and good reasons as well.
Right.
So the concept that everything is dark is kind of bad. I don't want everyone to get that impression because the Silk Road was the engaged in illegal activities.
The huge reason why DPR put the website up and allowed the market to begin with and took the risk was because BMP violence reduction in purchasing drugs is going to happen. And the reason it's going to happen is because of the war on drugs. Violence isn't just from the people buying and selling the drugs. Violence is from the police departments, the federal agents prosecuting this war, and not to mention the horrendous violence we commit overseas on people. I mean, we're the biggest bully on the planet when it comes to drugs. The fact that more than 50% of this country said, to the DEA, we don't want you prosecuting this war anymore. They need to demonize drugs. The war on drugs is, all about fear, uncertainty, doubt.
Robert's grown so rich he wants to retire. He took me to his cabin, told me a secret. I am not the Red Pirate Roberts, he said. My name is Ryan. I inherited the ship from the previous Red Pirate Roberts, just as you will inherit it from me. The man I inherited from was not the real Red Pirate Roberts either. His name was Kamagon. Real Roberts has been retired 15 years and living like a king in Patagonia. Then he explained the name was the important thing for inspiring the necessary fear. You see, no one can surrender to the Dread Pirate West. So we sailed ashore. At a time, he stayed aboard for a while as first mate, all the time calling me Roberts. Once the crew believed that he left the ship, and I have been Roberts ever since. But now we're together. I shall retire and have the name of myself.
We've been at Melbourne now for over 4 decades. And what has happened? since then. At the beginning, it was just the cartels and organized crime making a ton of money. They make globally $322 million off this movie. Corporate America is also now in the game. Private prisons. The Corrections Corporation of America. About a year ago, they gave out $675 million in dividends to the shareholders. Drug testing companies. It's now become a multi-billion dollar industry. And who gets tested? Those who are in prison or under the control of our criminal justice programs on parole and probation. So corporate America's making a lot of money. What about law enforcement? Law enforcement's making a ton of money. The government's 1033 program, you know, we get armored vehicles and machine guns and whatever we want of the surplus military equipment, that's because of the drug war. Over the years, we've seen these huge bureaucracies built up around the drug war, around prosecuting the drug war. You've got the Drug Enforcement Agency, you've got the Office of National Drug Control Policy. So a lot of the opposition is just rooted in self-interest among places like the FBI, where you're telling somebody who's been in the FBI for 30 years that drugs are no longer a priority. That's an existential threat to them. That kind of takes away their whole reason for existence.
When it comes to telephone calls, nobody is listening to your telephone calls.
You got any more questions, or should we wrap it up?
Yeah, future outlook. What are you going to do over the next 5 years? One sentence.
I'm going to... I'm going to do a few things. So one sentence isn't enough, damn it. But I want to... Pretty sure I want to start a family in the next 5 years.
That's okay.
Make more friends and close people I love. Yeah, I want to focus on being more connected to people.
Very good. And 20 years.
20 years. I want to have had a substantial positive impact on the future of humanity.
You think you're going to live forever?
I think there's a possibility. I honestly do. I think I might live forever in some form by that time. Technology is changing so fast.